Hey everybody, welcome to Stages of Life. I'm Jamal Evans, and this week I'm so excited to have author, writer, producer, and actress Miss Heather Jurgensen on the show. Some of you may be asking, well, who's Heather Jurgensen? Okay. Well, she's an incredibly talented individual that most notably co-authored and starred in one of my all-time favorite romantic comedies, Kissing Jessica Stein. She also starred in Red Roses and Petrol with Malcolm McDowell. She appeared in Haunted Mansion with Eddie Murphy, and she co-starred in the movie The Hammer with Adam Carolla. But before we get to the interview, I need you guys to hit that subscribe button. Subscribe to the channel. If you like the videos, hit that like button. Smash that notification button, and we'll let you know about future episodes. And make sure that you leave comments below. If you have comments for my guests, or if you have comments for me, or questions, we'll answer those comments right here on the Stages of Life channel. Well, Kissing Jessica Stein is a great movie. It's timeless, and I just thought it would be great if I could show you a clip from that movie. Here it is.
Wait a second. I'm sorry. Are you saying that my life has no value? No, I am saying that maybe, underneath all the neurosis, you have a profound capacity for happiness that you're not allowing.
Really? You think I could be profoundly
maybe.
Happy?
How do you know? How do you know? You can't possibly know who you are or how you'll respond to something until you try it.
Well, I happen to disagree. I happen to think if you know yourself well, you can gauge how you're going to react to something, and I can pretty much assure you that I will never be made happy by chanting for spiritual enlightenment.
Or maybe you would. You can't know.
Trust me, I know.
You know?
Yeah, I know.
You know how you'll react to everything?
Pretty much, yes.
I guess you're right. You seem to know yourself pretty well.
I think this movie is a timeless classic, worth the watch. More relevant today than it was when it was created. And I guess that's the big success, due to the success of the LGBTQ community and its movement. So again, this was a great film that you should check out if you get a chance. But, you know, right, let's just get right to it and welcome Heather Jurgensen to the show. Hey, Heather, how are you?
I'm good. How are you? Nice to be here, Jamal.
Thank you so much for coming on to the show. I really appreciate it. So I want to, you know, quickly talk about the format of our show is, well, we kind of feature you and your career. And we do that in a way by going through your history. We go through your present and then we go through your future. So right now, let's jump right into your history. And I know you have probably answered a million Jessica Stein questions ad nauseum. And I know you told me not to worry about that. But I'm going to try to focus on some questions that you may not have been asked. In that clip that we just watched, there was a horn beeping frantically in the background. Was that scripted or was that something that just happened as the sounds of New York?
That is so funny that you asked that, Jamal, because I only see this film from time to time, clips like this. When you played that clip just now, I literally said to myself, gee, did a car honk like spontaneously so perfectly as we were shooting? Or did we lay that in post? I have a feeling that was a live horn, like New York just being a character in the movie. And I'm going to go back and check with my director, but that is so interesting if it is live, which I think it is, because it was so perfect. It's like, beep, beep, Jessica, wake up, because your whole life's about to change.
I could tell you that I was wondering about that, and as well as... did somebody, like some, you know, crazy person was like, oh, look at that, two girls, and they're kissing there. Yeah. And oh, honking a horn. So I guess my first other question, what is your fondest memory from doing the movie that time period? And it can be anything from the development of the film or something that you did inside the film. But what do you remember most about Kissing Jessica Stein?
I probably would have to say, this movie took a lot to get made. It was made independently, truly independently. So that means we, as I say, shook the cup, raised money privately from everyone, from Uncle Joe to like Brad Zions, who was an AOL, early AOL executive who decided he wanted to make movies, and he was our angel investor. But in any event, it was a long road, and it was a rough road at times, exhausting at times. The first festival where we played the movie once it was completed was the Los Angeles Film Festival, which was a new film festival. And we played it there in 2001. It was a big screening. It had a great audience, tons of applause. And then at the end of that screening, we were invited to come up on the stage, me and Jennifer Westfeld, to, you know, sort of field questions. And I'll just never forget how thunderous the applause felt and how elated I felt to finally be showing this film, this baby that we'd worked on for so long, to people in a live audience. And it was just kind of a magical moment walking up there at that moment.
Cool. So other than Canada, in Toronto, where you had the film festival, what other places did you guys promote the film, and what other countries did you get to visit?
Yes, actually, let's see. What happened was Fox Searchlight, right? The sort of the art house arm of 20th Century Fox, they bought us at LAFF at that very first film festival, which was part of the real rags to riches quality of this movie and the sort of Cinderella quality, was that we toiled, we were worried, we hardly had two cents to rub together. We made the movie. And then at the very first festival where we played it, it got bought for, you know, a pretty good release, you know, considering it was starring two unknowns. And so once Fox Searchlight was in the mix, they were like, we're going to go to Toronto and we're going to go here, there, and the other. And so we were at the Deauville Festival in France, which is a really lovely French film festival. We did press in Australia, but I seem to recall I wasn't able to make that press in Australia. We were in London. We had a really lovely opening in London, which was nice because my mother and my aunt Muriel were both investors in the film with their little $5,000 or whatever it was. And so when we were in England, they were there too. And it was really, I'll never forget. I went up to this tiny town where they were in the north of England, and the Daily Mail, I believe, came to interview me there. And we got a great picture of me and my mom and my aunt against the Abbey in that town. We played it in Munich. And that was notable because it was in Munich that my husband ran around the city with John Hamm, who is also in the movie, to find an engagement ring for me.
Oh.
Because he was planning to propose to me in Paris, which was the next stop.
Oh, that's so cool. That's cool. Okay. That was good. That was informative. As you know, we touched base before, and you told me that there would be no questions that are off limits, but I did a little poll and asked a couple of people, what question would you want me to ask Heather? And this is the one that just kept coming up. And again, I'm going to have this as a caveat before, you know, at the end of this question. But the question is, did you get hit on by any other female celebrities after the film? And again, you do not have to mention any names, but yes or no. Did you have questions about your sexuality or get hit on by other celebrities in Hollywood?
I definitely got hit on by women. That was a learning curve for me, having never had that happen to me before. I don't think it was necessarily like celebrity women. It was just women. Like women would come up to me in restaurants and just say, I loved your movie. And it was clear that like a move was being made. I was like, I mean, I was dating Kevin at the time and we weren't yet engaged, but we were together. We'd been dating since like 1998. So we were a couple. So it was just as if a man was hitting on me. It's like, oh, this is so flattering, but I'm so spoken for. I think I didn't really question my sexuality. I'd had sexual adventures, if you will, when I was younger. I suppose now, I don't know, it seems like everyone's bi today, but back then we would call it bi curious. So I had those days. I concluded I was pretty straight. Like I could might have a sexual exploit with a woman, but it was like guys were kind of my thing in terms of relationships. And so it was interesting to be hit on by women because it was like, oh my God, like this chick's hitting on me, like, wow. But it was still all for naught because A, I was in a relationship, and B, you know.
I gotcha.
Gay or bi, so yeah.
Okay. Well, there it is, ladies and gentlemen. She is not gay or bi, so cut that shit out, okay?
But my heart's in the right place, I promise you.
Okay. Hindsight being 2020, there's a if there was one thing that you could change about Kissing Jessica Stein, other than the classic, the ending, and you know, that's classic. What one thing could you change if there was something you can change today?
Well, you know, so many things worked out beautifully, actually. Even though we had very little money, we had so much good human energy and so much creativity and resourcefulness that even though we had a very tiny budget, we always were able to, like, you know, make New York kind of look like $1 million and all this stuff. But one thing that bugged me when we were shooting that continues to kind of stick in my craw, so to speak, was Jessica was supposed to work at the New York Times. That was how it was written in the script. Like, she was a young, you know, writer at the big paper of record, you know, the big, beautiful New York Times. And we just couldn't get a big office like that. They're too expensive, honestly. And Charlie, our director, and Eden Wormfield, our producer, who are happen to be brother and sister, their uncle teaches at Hunter College. And so he said to us, you can use my office, which is like this little teeny cramped old office at Hunter College. And we said, well, okay, thank you, because that's all we could get. And so people over the years have, I've heard people assume that, like, Jessica works at, like, the Village Voice or some little weekly paper when she's supposed to be working at, like, the big New York Times. So that's the type of thing that if I could go back, I probably, and if money were no object, I would probably make it that gorgeous big set so you knew that better, you know?
Right. Okay. So another question that came up, or another thing we discussed in a pre-meeting, was I was always in my life waiting for from the director, from the writers of Kissing Jessica Stein, mm-hmm. you know, and you turned me on to the movie The Hammer with Adam Carolla. And I just want to show the audience a little clip from that movie. Here it is.
From the people who brought you Kissing Jessica Stein.
Eastern philosophy says that you expend massive amounts of chi when
Eastern philosophy?
And the guy who brought you The Man Show.
We're in Burbank, Grasshopper. And I got enough chi for the whole valley.
Oh, yeah?
Okay, so what was most memorable about The Hammer for you? What was the most memorable scene?
Well, that's easy. That was when... let me just give a little backstory first for people that don't know about The Hammer. The Hammer was the brainchild of Adam Carolla, who came from radio and now has a podcast. And at the time he did The Man Show, that was in the late 90s. And my husband, Kevin Hench, who wrote for him on The Man Show, Adam used to be a Golden Gloves boxer. So he always had this dream of making a movie about a kind of over the hill, kind of down on his luck guy who becomes a boxer. And so they thought of the story together. Kevin went and wrote it. And then I went back to my Kissing Jessica Stein team and said, hey, this is a pretty good script. Do you want to get together and make another movie? And we did. And I play the love interest. So the thing is, though, Adam's the star. He's buddies with my husband. And so the day came when he and I had to have our kissing scene.
Right.
And Kevin was like, oh, I don't want to see my buddy kiss my wife. And, you know, and so he, like, scuttled off to go home and feed the dogs. And we did our best to, like, shoot it quick. And, you know, it was a little weird, but we did it. And it's such a cute scene. I think that is one of the most charming love scenes actually of all time, because Adam's so cute in it. And anyway, so that was a weird moment.
Well, you did a great job. And I would imagine that would be weird. So I'm glad he went home and took care of the dog.
It was weirdest on Kevin, I think, maybe on Adam, but I don't know, as an actress, I just felt like that's my job, you know?
Exactly. Well, it was a great movie. Thank you for turning me onto it. I didn't know about it. And if you guys haven't taken a look at The Hammer with Adam Carolla and my dear friend here, Heather Jerkinson.
Sports Illustrated named it the best sports comedy of the year. I don't know how many sports comedies are made every year, but
cool.
It got a nod from Sports Illustrated.
Cool. I did not know that either. So we're going to make sure that everybody that's watching this gets to take a look at that as well.
Okay, good.
Okay. So I'm going to ask you a two-parter for the last question here. So it's a two-part for the history. Number one is, what was it like to work on Haunted Mansion with Eddie Murphy? What was that like?
Oh, that was such a fun day of shooting. First of all, he's such a pro. It was fascinating to just watch him do great take after take. And I was such a huge fan. I mean, my God, growing up with Eddie Murphy and everything. So I was, like, just gushing with him on set, trying to be cool, but, like, oh my God, I'm acting with Eddie Murphy. And I will say that, you know, that cliche is true, that when you're, like, running the scene, like me and the other actor, Steve Heitner, we were running the scene with the director, Rob Minkoff, a terrific director, and we're just working it and talking about it. And the whole time it's like Eddie's in his trailer because there's, like, a stand in there. And then everything's ready. And then I hear the first AD go, A team, you know, and then Eddie comes in and just sits down. And then it's like, cameras are go, we're about to shoot.
Right.
And it's like, we just sat with him. And so, But yeah, he was a terrific guy.
Oh, cool. That would blow me away too, because I'm a huge Eddie Murphy fan. So that's so cool that you got to do that. Okay. The next question in this one is something that I noticed by watching Red Roses and Petrol. I thought that your Irish accent was outstanding, and I was wondering what you did to prepare yourself to pick up that accent. Did you do any special training? What did you do?
Well, thank you for asking that question, because I did work very hard on that accent, and I don't know if anyone's ever asked me about it. That was a very tiny movie that only was in theaters for about 5 minutes. I'll tell you exactly what I did. First of all, that was such a tiny budget. There was no money really for a proper dialogue coach, which normally you would have on a movie to help like an American. We had British actors and I was the only American on the set. Anyway, so what I did was I rented a typical Irish movie of the time, which I'm blanking on the name, but it was just an Irish movie. And I went home and this is dating me, but I still had an audio cassette recorder. I taped the movie. I played the movie on my DVD player and I put in my little audio cassette and taped it. Then when I was driving around town in my little Honda Civic with a little tape player, oh my God, this was 2003. I would play that movie just washing over me. So all day long, I was just listening to this movie over and over again. I'm going to get you the name of it, by the way. And I would like sort of repeat back the lines over and over all day long. And so by the time I got onto set of Red Roses, you know, I'd been working it for a while and it was different lines of dialogue, but I could extrapolate and I could, you know.
Right.
So that was what I did. I just worked it.
Well, let me tell you, Heather, I thought that you did a terrific job on the accent. It's something that stood out. As a person that knows you, it's something that stood out to me, that it had to be something that was difficult for you to pick up, and you did a great job. I was totally convinced that you were Irish.
Well, thank you.
And
you know,
the dance.
I'm not one of those people that can pick up an accent in a minute, but if I hear it enough, then I can start repeating it. So that's what I did. I put in the time.
Well, it was awesome. Great job. Okay. So that's going to take us over to the next stage of this. So before we leave her pass, I want everybody take a look. I'll leave in a description below links to all these movies so you could take a look at them and check out Heather and these films. Stage two, your present. Let's talk about what you're doing today. So what are you up to these days?
So these days I am a breathwork teacher. Okay. Which is funny because breathwork is a huge part of acting. I do believe there are things I do now, because I don't really act anymore. I mean, I'm available to act, but I'm not like playing the game and, you know, driving around to meetings and auditioning and all that.
So all you directors out there that, I think you better give Heather some scripts. Yeah, get her some scripts. It's nonsense that we're waiting to see her on screen again. But I'm sorry. Go ahead, Heather.
Any casting person or director listening, I am so available to you. I just don't have the energy for the game anymore. Everyone knows what that is in the business. It's like there's these gears that move and like it's who's on the list for casting. And if you're on that list, you get called in and it's the same six people. Anyway, I just lost my energy for it all after I had my first baby. When I had Sophie, my first child, I kind of like got really into motherhood. I was like, it was like just something that I took to. And I think I was a little exhausted with Hollywood, just the whole scene. You know, I had been at it from multiple angles. I had been an actress, like a working actress. I had been a producer and screenwriter.
Right.
I had been hired as a screenwriter for hire. And, you know, married to a writer and just kind of like, I would go on pitch meetings. I mean, it was like a lot.
Right.
And there is a certain cynicism in Hollywood, which over time started to wear on me more and more. Like, I have a kind of, I think the essence of my soul is really that of an innocent. Like, I really do. I like to see things like with those beginner's eyes. And I'm very experiential. There was a part of me that just couldn't keep doing that, that jaded eye roll aspect of Hollywood.
Right.
So I had my baby and then I got really interested in stuff like organic food and, you know, regenerative farming and small farmers, because I was suddenly feeding this tiny little creature. And as I'd always been kind of interested in that, but this really blew it up. So at some point when Sophie was like a wee little one, I took a health coaching certification. And just more recently, I did a breathwork certification. And now,
so what exactly is breathwork? What exactly is
breathwork? That's a big question. That's sort of like saying, what is fitness? You know, because there's so many ways to enter into it. So I will say this: breathwork is becoming conscious of your breath at its most fundamental level. And you get conscious of your in-breath, and you get conscious of your out-breath, and you get conscious of what's called the hold.
Okay.
You can hold the breath. And I do different kinds of breath work with people. Some of it is calming, some of it is sort of anti-anxiety, but the type that I love the most, that's most exciting in a way, is something known that I call it dynamic breath work. It's also what's known as a heavy breath work. Mm-hmm. So it's like this, it's like you're not supposed to breathe through your mouth in everyday life, but this is a very focused, conscious 20 minutes of breathing through the mouth. And what it does is it opens up all of our creativity and our emotional blocks. And it's maybe the most dramatic kind of breath work in terms of people having big breakthroughs.
Okay.
So that is my favorite way of leading people, is in that like heavier, more dynamic type of breath work.
Good. And do you have, what I would like you to do is just share any sites or any programs that you have that we can promote for you. We'll put it in a description below with everything else. So
HeatherJurgensen.com. Okay. HeatherJurgensen.com is my main site, and you can just click on the breathwork button there. And I also, if you go to Book Breathwork, that's my breathwork page. So either one of those places will get you more information about that.
Cool. Promote, girl. Go ahead. Promote. I love it.
I love it. No, I want the whole world to see. The thing about the breath, it's right there. It's right there with us at all times. And most people we go through our life, however you're breathing, you don't think about it. And as soon as you get conscious of it, you also get conscious of your whole life. It's really profound.
All right. That's cool. So before we go into your future segments, we historically here like to play a little bit of a game. And
okay.
I come up with a new one just for you. So here's the game. It's called Spin That Line. And here's how you play it, right? I take a popular line, and I'm only going to do one because I know we don't have that much time, and I appreciate your time. So I'm only going to do one. But I'll do one, and I'll demonstrate what the line means. So from the movie with Tom Cruise and Jack Nicholson, A Few Good Men. All right. So there's a scene that's the courtroom scene that's really tremendous. And Tom Cruise is getting into this heavy heated argument with Jack Nicholson. And then he goes, "I want the truth." And Jack Nicholson says, "You can't handle the truth." And that's one of those famous lines. So the point of the game is spin that line, right? And to say, how would you interpret that line differently from the original actress or actor? So as an example, right?
Wait, but you have to keep the same words?
You have to keep the same words, but you can have a different tonation. I'll give you an example, right?
So this is like a cover. We're covering the line.
Exactly. So
you're a cover song. Yeah.
You're kind of spinning it in your own way. So if Tom Cruise said to me, "I want the truth," and I would go, "You can handle the truth," same line, but delivered differently, right? A different spin. And then the producers here at our show will rank, you know, how well that was. So I want them to rank what I just did. And I'll give you another one just as an example. "I want the truth. You can't handle the truth." You see what I mean? So that's what we're going to do.
I get it.
Got it?
Okay.
All right. So now you are going to deliver the line from, and this is going to be your line. "I'm just a girl standing in front of a boy asking her to love him." Okay. And so now you're going to deliver that line your way. Okay. And when I say action, you're going to be ready. Take a moment and let me know.
Wait a minute. I just want to get those line. "I'm just a girl standing in front of a boy asking him
to love her."
To love her. Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
That's your line. Are you ready? And again, we're gonna.
I feel like I'm auditioning again, Jamal. This is terrible.
No, it's fun because then we're gonna producers are here. Rank it. And
that's why I didn't do better at auditions. I forgot how fun they were. Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Yes, I want to do this. This is such a lovely line. Okay.
And this is gonna be Heather Jurgensen delivering Julia Roberts' line from what the hell was the name of that movie? Oh, Notting Hill. Yeah, that was a line. Okay. And when you're ready, you tell me and I'll say action. Action.
"I'm just a girl standing in front of a boy asking him to love her."
All right. Well done. All right. Well, I'm not going to rank it, but when this episode comes out, you'll see the ranking.
Be kind. everybody on the Stages of Life team.
They're going to rank it out real good.
And remember, something on the fly.
I'm in charge, so I won't let them do anything bad to you.
Okay. Be gentle. Be gentle, people.
All right. So that takes us to our last stage, your future. So I have some questions about your future and some...
Well, I have some questions about my future. Do you have a psychic on your staff?
Well, maybe. We might have somebody that can help you. But that being said, I do have this one thing I want to plug with you. I'm always plugging things. So I still hope to see another trailer that says, from the writers of Kissing Jessica Stein. Another trailer.
Uh-huh.
From the writers of Kissing Jessica Stein comes a new comedy about race relations in America called American Swirl. What do you think of that?
Wow.
And yeah, I think it would be really cool if your writing skills, coupled with some of your friends from Kissing Jessica Stein, wrote another comedy that was about interracial relationships, but made it funny and called it American Swirl. What do you think of that?
I love that, Jamal. Did you know that back in the day when I was a young actress, I had a one-woman show called Black Wannabe?
No, I did not know that.
Yes, and it was about being raised white in a black neighborhood.
Oh, that's even cooler.
It was really about racial identity, but of course, not you know, interracial and biracial is kind of a better lens, but it was what it was a big part of my childhood. So anyway, I feel I'm halfway there with you, Jamal.
Okay.
I would love to make a movie like that, actually, and I don't know about the rest of the team, although I will say... I've always been fascinated by any theme around identity and how we craft our identity, and how identities get forged. And I think some of the other creatives from Kissing Jessica Stein would find that interesting as well. But I cannot speak for anyone, but maybe, who knows, you know, we start visualizing something and the universe starts moving the pieces.
Well, I could tell you, I have the log line for you. So you just let me know and I'll send it over to you.
Tell me. I want to hear it right now.
I don't have it fully written. You know me. I have to write everything down. But I think it would be really cool. And if it was either way, interracial and the same types of problems, sort of the same type of problems. And, you know, Tova also could be perfect for one of these roles because she delivered some powerful, powerful acting in Kissing Jessica Stein. But I thought
she
was great.
Like the grand...
Well, you know what? I've exhausted my time and I wanted to just say thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. I hope you come back anytime you're in New York. We maybe can get in and do this in person so we don't have to go through this Zoom stuff.
Thank you.
And we'll bring you in.
It was my pleasure, Jamal. Such so nice to talk with you.
Oh, thank you, Heather. I really appreciate your times. And I want to thank Heather for coming on to the show and tell everybody, make sure you subscribe to the channel, visit everything so you could see this tremendous actress at work. Thank you, Heather, for being on the show. Guys, make sure you subscribe to the channel, hit that like button, make sure you get future notifications, and leave comments so we could talk. Again, I want to thank my guest Heather Jurgensen for being on the show. Heather, thank you so much, and I want to wish you all the best in the future.
Thank you, Jamal. Same to you.
Take care.